The dinosaurs were incredibly successful during the Mesozoic era, but what are the reasons for that success? In today's video, I'm going to be talking about why dinosaurs were so successful in the Mesozoic era when they dominated Earth, and in doing so, I'm going to be debunking a few dinosaur misconceptions. So, the Mesozoic era, as shown on this geologic timescale, includes the Triassic period, the Jurassic period, and the Cretaceous period, all together going from around 252 million years ago to 65 million years ago when the asteroid hit and the non-avian dinosaurs went extinct. Just for a little bit of background about dinosaurs before we get into why they were so successful, dinosaurs evolved from dinosauromorphs, which evolved from reptiles in the Triassic. And dinosaurs pretty much didn't become huge and dominant until the Jurassic. Triassic dinosaurs were mostly small and were not the dominant land animals at the time. There were still very diverse and widespread therapsids, which were major land animals at the time that were major competitors to dinosaurs. And then after the late Triassic mass extinction, those guys mostly went extinct so that dinosaurs could become dominant. As we know, non-avian dinosaurs went extinct at the K-PG boundary, like I just mentioned, and the only dinosaurs to survive this extinction were birds, which still live today, as we know. So, in terms of what I mean when dinosaurs were successful, they basically had a size, diversity, and abundance advantage over other land animals, such as mammals, throughout the entire Mesozoic era. Although both the dinosaurs and the mammals evolved in the Triassic, dinosaurs evolved slightly earlier, around 240 to 230 million years ago, whereas mammals evolved just after that, around 200 to 175 million years ago. By the time mammals had evolved at that point, dinosaurs were already around to keep them pretty much small prey type animals. They were mostly nocturnal climbers and burrowers. They were the things that ran away from the dinosaurs. This timing difference not only gave the dinosaurs an advantage over mammals, but also gave them time to evolve and diversify before the end Triassic extinction event. I have a whole video about that extinction event, and I'll link it to the top right. And in that, I also talk about why dinosaurs fared so well through that extinction event. Remember, that's the first period in the Mesozoic. That was long before the asteroid impact extinction event at the end of the Cretaceous. The diversity of dinosaurs by the time that extinction event occurred made them less susceptible to extinction because more diverse animals mean more of those animals have a chance to survive whatever climatic or environmental changes come their way. And we know from the fossil record that dinosaurs were incredibly diverse. And not only was the entire group or clade Dinosauria very diverse in terms of diverse species, but even single species were environmentally versatile. Because of the range of different environments we've found dinosaur species in the rock record, we know that they were able to live in versatile environments, which made them even more able to adapt to climatic and environmental changes. But in terms of their success throughout the Mesozoic era, they weren't actually completely dominant and ruling over pretty much the entire terrestrial realm of Earth until the Jurassic period. So during the Triassic, before the Jurassic and Cretaceous, they still had to share a lot of the available land niches with other land animals. However, after the late Triassic mass extinctions that wiped out most of the therapsids, which were major competitors to them in the Triassic period, the dinosaurs were able to take over pretty much all land niches in the Jurassic period, which they continued to dominate in the Cretaceous. This means they ruled land for around 140 million years. But there are many misconceptions about dinosaurs, as well as the reasons for their success. And that is what we'll talk about now. So, the first misconception we'll talk about is dinosaur size. It's often thought that all dinosaurs were absolutely huge. But actually, many dinosaurs were less than 1 meter or 3 feet long, including those that survived into the Cenozoic. As we see today, most birds are pretty small. But this didn't make them less successful. Being large in size is helpful in some scenarios, but being small in size is also evolutionarily advantageous in some cases, and that's why these small dinosaurs continued to evolve and diversify throughout the Mesozoic and into the Cenozoic. One specific type of dinosaur, the Velociraptors, continue to get overestimated in size in movies, I see. The velociraptors in Jurassic Park and Jurassic World are quite big, like almost as tall as humans, whereas in real life, they were quite short. However, there were other raptor dinosaurs that did get bigger. But as you can see, the velociraptor was pretty tiny compared to those other groups. So I'm not sure why they didn't use a different group of raptors. Maybe the other names were harder to pronounce. Or didn't sound as cool. That's my only guess. I don't know. Another misconception is dinosaur speed, although, as you'll see as I go through this slide, it might not be a misconception after all. So, in movies, we see velociraptors and even T-Rexes chasing after cars, for example, or motorcycles. And in reality, if your car goes over 20 miles an hour, you're probably safe, at least from the T-Rexes. Small dinosaurs like velociraptors were extremely agile, similar to ostriches today. Their top speed was around 40 miles per hour. Now, I rewatched the scene where Chris Pratt is like riding with them on his motorcycle, and I don't know, maybe they were only going 40 miles an hour. Maybe they do get it right in the movies. I couldn't really tell. But if he was going over 40, then they couldn't have kept up, because that's their top sprinting speed. And even slower were large dinosaurs like T-Rexes, which only got up to around 20 miles per hour. However, I will say that in the movies, I don't think I ever see them having the T-Rexes go all that fast. So maybe they did consult some scientists and get it right. I mean, don't get me wrong, I love the Jurassic Park and World movies, but I was just trying to analyze them to see if the speeds were off. But altogether, they get the speeds relatively correct. I think it's the size of the velociraptors that they got a little bit off, as well as the lack of feathers. But I get that in movies, it would look really funny and a little bit quirky for the dinosaurs to have feathers, so I forgive them. An older misconception is that dinosaurs were reptiles, or at least similar to reptiles. And although they evolved from dinosauromorphs, which evolved from reptiles, if we think about the major groups of animals today and we're trying to pick, were dinosaurs more like modern reptiles or modern birds? They were more like modern birds, which totally makes sense because birds are dinosaurs. But it's important to note that even the ones that weren't bird ancestors, like the ornithischians, were more like modern birds than they were like modern reptiles. Recall in my Terrestrial Life and Triassic Jurassic video that saurischians or lizard-hipped dinosaurs evolved into birds and ornithischians or bird-hipped dinosaurs didn't, which is kind of confusing, but you know, it's just the way we named them based on their bone shapes before we knew how the evolutionary, you know, lines actually worked. But anyway, the ones that are not at all directly related to birds still were more bird-like than reptile-like. And I'm not sure if this was ever a misconception, but we can also tell from fossil trackways that many dinosaurs were social and traveled in herds. Some herds may have even been as vastly spread across continental land masses as the American bison were before their populations dwindled due to hunting. These dinosaurs in these herds even communicated with each other. For example, the duck-billed dinosaurs had tall crested skulls that functioned like the resonating chambers of a trumpet, and this allowed them to call to each other over large distances. And now, getting to potentially the most highly debated question about dinosaurs, or at least maybe it used to be, is whether they were warm-blooded or cold-blooded, aka endothermic or ectothermic. We used to think that they were ectothermic, but with not a lot of evidence to back that up. We basically thought they were more reptile-like based on purely morphology in the beginning. And because we thought that they'd also have to be ectothermic. But now we have piles of evidence pointing toward endothermy, or at least for most of the dinosaur species, they seem to have been endothermic or warm-blooded. I'm going to go through several lines of evidence for endothermy over ectothermy in the next few slides, and the first bit of evidence is endurance. Ectotherms, or cold-blooded animals, have slow metabolisms, which means low energy, which means low endurance. But endotherms have fast metabolisms and high energy, which means high endurance. One argument that dinosaurs had high endurance is based on the fact that if they didn't, they probably wouldn't have been able to suppress the mammals for so long. But another piece of evidence for their high endurance is more quantitative. It's based on their speeds and how long they can maintain speed. And this is all based on their trackways. And we can calculate, based on their foot size, their body size, and their stride length, how fast they were going and how long they could maintain those speeds. Trackways indicate that they maintain speed rather than making only short bursts like ectotherms do. Reptiles and other ectotherms can only do short bursts of energy and then rest for a while. They don't have endurance to maintain speed. Another piece of evidence for endothermy over ectothermy is the low ratio of predators to prey in dinosaur communities. In dinosaur communities preserved in the rock record, carnivores made up less than 10% of biomass, and this is also the case for living in fossil mammals. The reason the carnivores are rare in mammal communities is because they need a lot of food to maintain their high metabolism. So the predators are low in percentage, while the food, the prey, has to be very high in percentage for them to even be able to get enough prey to live. In ectotherms, however, predators make up about 40% of biomass in these communities because they don't need quite as much food to maintain their biomass. If you've ever had a pet reptile, you know that you don't have to feed it as often as your pet dog. My family and I used to have pet snakes, and they ate like once every 3 weeks. It was pretty incredible. The next bit of evidence for endothermy over ectothermy is their bone structures. In other words, the amount of tubes available in their preserved bones for blood vessels. Dinosaur bones have an abundance of tubes to house blood vessels, and these bones resemble those of modern endotherms. Endotherms require numerous blood vessels to maintain their high metabolisms, whereas reptiles or ectotherms don't need as many blood vessels because they have lower metabolisms. Another bit of evidence for endothermy over ectothermy is dinosaur parents brooding their eggs. We've seen dinosaur mothers preserved while brooding their eggs in the rock record, and because we know that reptiles and other ectotherms cannot raise their body temperatures above the environment, they don't need to sit on their eggs to incubate them because that wouldn't do anything, whereas endotherms can do so to incubate their eggs because their body temperatures are higher. Another piece of evidence for endothermy is their rapid growth rates. Baby dinosaurs as large as 1.5 meters or 5 feet have been preserved while still in their nest. We can see that with the presence of eggshells around where the baby dinosaurs were preserved. Knowing that that species hatches around only a few inches in length, this implies a high growth rate, meaning that they got to 1.5 meters or 5 feet in just a few months before they left the nest. Annual growth bands in dinosaur bones confirm these fast growth rates. We can see and measure annual growth bands of dinosaur bones preserved in the rock record, and one example is Tyrannosaurus. Tyrannosaurus grew so fast that it reached a weight of half a ton by the time it was only 12 or 13 years old. These rates of growth are much faster than ectotherms can achieve. Another piece of evidence for endothermy is feathers. Feathers and feather-like structures have been preserved with numerous dinosaur fossils, and some of these structures wouldn't have aided in flight, so it's likely that they were for insulation. We've seen the evolution of dinosaur feathers in the Mesozoic go from just simple filaments to clustered filaments and finally to fully branched feathers. And in some cases, we're able to tell what colors the feathers might have been, and I'll talk about that in a later slide. Another piece of evidence for endothermy are oxygen isotopes in the bones of preserved dinosaurs, which reflect the temperature at which the bone was secreted, aka the body temperature of the preserved dinosaur. Body temperatures of ectotherms vary, whereas endotherms typically are pretty uniform. And for example, reptiles' extremities are warmer in summer than in winter. But it turns out that most dinosaurs had uniform body temperatures similar to modern mammals and birds, and therefore were probably endothermic. But there are some that vary, indicating that some dinosaurs may have been ectothermic or maybe just partially endothermic. Another evidence for endothermy is that they could handle cold winters. Diverse dinosaur fauna occupied Australia in the Cretaceous period when it was at the South Pole. Fossil plants in this region from the same time period suggest that the winters got quite cold, and only endotherms would have been able to survive such conditions. Again, ectotherms aren't able to rise their body temperature to temperatures higher than the environment, so they would have frozen to death had they tried to live in such an environment. So that's all for the evidence of endothermy over ectothermy, but now I'm going to talk a little bit about some other factors that led to dinosaur success. The first are gastroliths. One might ask how very large herbivores at the time were able to chew up enough food to maintain their high metabolism. And one thing that aided in this process were gastroliths. Gastroliths are exactly what they sound like. They're like rocks in their intestinal tracts that ground up food after it's been swallowed and help them digest it. And I think most, if not all, birds have these today. Another reason many species of dinosaurs were successful is that they evolved to be able to dig burrows. Not only were there small burrowing dinosaurs that actually lived in burrows, but there were dinosaurs that hunted burrowing mammals that they then could dig out and eat. So it was pretty advantageous for them to evolve this ability. Another really advantageous ability for them to evolve was the ability to swim. This is an example of Spinosaurus, which could swim and even hunt prey while swimming. Even duck-billed dinosaurs had webbed rear feet, so many dinosaur species were able to swim even if it wasn't their primary mode of mobility. Another advantage, or just interesting fact, is that some dinosaurs that became isolated on islands at the time became much smaller than their mainland relatives. And island dwarfism is actually somewhat common in the rock record because of the smaller land area providing food. Actually, in separate videos, I talk about how elephants in the Pleistocene that were isolated on islands also became dwarfed. Another advantage, at least for the very long-necked dinosaurs, were hollow neck bones. These dinosaurs evolved hollow neck bones just so that they could lift up that enormous weight of their necks, and so that they could grow long necks and then reach the highest vegetation that was out of the reach of other dinosaurs and other animals. Another potential factor that led to dinosaur success, but unverified, was that some species were venomous. Now, in my book, they actually do say that Cinerithosaurus, as shown down here, was venomous, and that's because of a cavity within its upper jaw that likely housed venom, or at least that's how it looks preserved in the rock record. But I went online to verify because I'm a fact checker, and I don't know if that's all that proven as my textbook makes it sound like. So I'm just putting the disclaimer here that there is evidence that supports that they were venomous, and there's a lot of evidence that also says that that's just a remnant of how the fossil was altered after it was buried and preserved. So that's not certain. But you know, we're still looking. We might find something in the future that confirms it or denies it. The last key to their success slash just cool dinosaur fact that I want to talk about is the colors of their feathers. How do we know what color their feathers were, you ask? Well, melanosomes are large organelles that produce, store, and transport pigments. Their concentrations within the cells, as well as their shapes and orientations, change depending on the color of the pigment that they transport, store, and produce. The marginal area of the cell where the melanosomes are located protrude, and therefore, pits within neighboring feather tissues provide evidence for the traits of these melanosomes in fossil record. Studies of melanosome imprints in fossil feathers indicate that many late Jurassic and early Cretaceous dinosaurs had black feathers with a sheen similar to modern ravens. But one dinosaur from the late Jurassic found in China had black feathers with white stripes and a reddish-brown crest around its head. So all in all, it's safe to say that dinosaurs were quite advanced and successful animals, and it's probably safe to say that they still are. Even the non-avian dinosaurs that have now gone extinct would probably fare pretty well in the modern world if Jurassic Park or World ever came true. Spoiler alert, however, it won't. It's impossible. I can talk about that in a separate video if you want me to, but it's, you know, genetic material being preserved that long in the rock record, first of all, wouldn't happen, and even if it did, it wouldn't be possible to fill in the gaps the way they suggests that it would in those movies. But anyway, if you get anything out of this video at all, it's that their extinction was an abiotic catastrophe and had nothing to do with any sort of biological inferiority on their part. As I mentioned, they were incredibly successful and advanced, and clearly it wasn't until they were gone that mammals could even diversify and enlarge and rise to dominance. So clearly, they had quite the hold over us, or at least our ancestors. If you want to know more about other terrestrial life that was around during the Triassic and Jurassic periods, you can check out the video to the left that will pop up here any second. You can also check out my late Triassic mass extinction video that explains why the extinction event happened, as well as why dinosaurs fared so well during and after that event. And you can also check out other videos in my historical geology playlist, as it'll pop up down below any second now. And if you want to check out the major reference I'm using for this and other videos in that playlist, it's called Earth Systems History, and it's linked in my description below. And that is all I have for today. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.